Gearhart's back.
The more things change, the more they stay the same.
From NJ1015.com, this is the new Jim Gearhart Podcast.
Well, hello, I'm Jim Gearhart, along with Patrick Labrie from New Jersey 101.5 News. Pat, I got to start today to get something kind of off my chest, in a sense. I've been wrestling with the devil, or with the angels, I guess, to put it that way, and
sure.
Gone to the mat with the numinous powers over this. It gets down to this with the sentencing, the big stories you've seen, the sentencing of Carton.
Yes.
Who people didn't know used to work here years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And going back to those days, I don't know what's happened since then, but going back to those days when he was here for about 3 years, he was pretty well universally considered by the staff to be, as I'd expressed before, a cancer on the radio station.
Mm-hmm.
Here was a man that operated out of relentless malice toward former or fellow employees, especially me. I don't know why. I never met him.
Okay.
Never met him in 3 years. I did the morning show. He did the afternoon show.
Right.
There was about a four-hour gap in between. Mm-hmm. So I was gone. He came in. But for some reason, every day, he would come up with something to malign me. I don't know why. He used to say, well, that old guy in the morning. You know, just, and so I, at the time, you know, people would say, well, why don't you get back? Well, there's an old axiom that I think is very sound that says, never get into a pissing match with a skunk. And I thought that was the better part of discretion there.
Yeah, yeah.
But he did totally malicious things.
Mm-hmm.
One, for example, as a classic example, I was shopping at a market, and we were on television in the morning at the time.
Yeah.
And so people locally would get to know you and who you are. I was in the checkout line, and a lady came in and said, do you know what they're saying about you on the radio? I said, well, no, I have no idea. Well, it's awful. You should hear what they're saying about you in the afternoon. Well, come to find out, he had come up with a story, and they did about 20 minutes on this, that I had made fun of ladies with breast cancer and had maligned them and was somehow disparaging them.
Mm-hmm.
In my wildest flight of fancy, would never even evil fancy.
Right.
I would never have thought of such a thing.
Right.
It was ridiculous.
Most people wouldn't.
No.
Yeah.
And yet, this is the kind of stuff that he did. And at the time, it got bad, and so I talked to the general manager of the station, and said, "Look, at least in that case, have him go on and say that was a mistake. That was not true. Nothing like that ever happened."
Yeah.
Well, the manager says, well, no, he doesn't apologize for anything. I said, no apology, just say it was wrong. Well, he doesn't do that. And I said, well, Andy, why do you put up with this stuff?
Yeah.
He said, well, he's going to make me a whole lot of money.
Right.
Now, at the time, I thought he meant, oh, he's going to get great ratings, which at the time, his ratings weren't any different than anybody else's, except in his mind.
Right.
He was running the radio station.
Right.
And everybody else here was sort of hanging on his coattails. Lucky to be able to feed our families based on his genius, which he expressed to everybody. But I looking back, and I had to think after this, the Ponzi scheme,
yeah.
Maybe he's letting the general manager in on the Ponzi. I don't know. He was going to make him a whole lot of money. The point is, and I think what gets me now, this was a very unhappy time. And he would do this daily. Now, he had a toady sidekick. And the sidekick was a good broadcaster, but he never got a chance to broadcast goodly because his job was simply, everything that Carton said, his job was to say, that's right, oh, indubitably, yeah, without any doubt. And so he sort of went along with the gag. He had to, I guess, to keep the job.
Yeah.
But in spite, it left some very bad feelings, very bad feelings. I notice now, I guess what brings this up and brought it back to light, the immense public relations campaign that's being put on right now to save him. Now, he was, for anybody who might not know this, and I wouldn't expect everybody to, he was involved in, what, $5 million, I believe it was, financial scam.
Yeah, I don't know the exact... I don't know the exact figure, but it was wide-ranging.
And in a sense, he stole money from people through fraud.
Yeah.
He was convicted of it. Many accounts, a laundry list of accounts.
Yep.
Now, his, as best I can remember, is probably the biggest financial fraud since Bernie Madoff. Well, Bernie Madoff,
right,
manned up.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And he said, I did it. It was wrong. And he faced up the logical consequences of his act.
Sure.
He didn't put on a public relations circus and claim, you know, the usual thing. It's obligatory to say you were abused when you were a kid and you were picked on in school and all of this business. Mm. And M&Ms melted in your hand when you were a kid. And right. This sort of got me. And you get now the people who are defending him and begging for mercy from the court. I don't know who the judge is, know nothing about the judge. Judges are human.
Mm-hmm.
They may be affected by this. And so we have former Governor Chris Christie is begging now for mercy for this wonderful person.
Right.
And why? I don't know his motives, of course. Obviously, he has a motive.
Yeah.
But will this set some kind of a mood in the judge to actually mitigate the sentence? Now, his partner in this scam, the partner got, 2 years?
Yes, I believe so.
Now, you would expect the ringleader to get more, but I don't know what they are.
I don't know if that's going to happen. And when you mention this PR campaign and all these letters, there were some 90 letters that were written on his behalf.
Oh, yeah. It's very well organized.
Yeah.
And, of course, that's what I thought was kind of... and also, one of the claims is, in addition to this abuse, I have no idea about that, naturally. Mm. Could be, who knows. But I remember he did an interview with the Star-Ledger, which is the largest circulation newspaper in New Jersey. And the interview was about politics and about him and his life.
Mm-hmm.
And the only thing that had got anything back to the young life, there's nothing like that, alleged. But he did indicate that he had a very difficult time, sort of animosity to his father.
Okay.
And it seemed like what you gleaned from reading the story, the problem was that his father, who I believe was a doctor, a physician, didn't have sufficient appreciation for his son's cosmic high qualities.
Right.
Wasn't
right.
appreciated.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's abuse in the mind of a person.
Right.
Of that mindset, I guess it is. If you feel that you are the light of the noonday sun.
Yeah.
Then anybody who doesn't go along with the gag. But I, again, to try to make an end of the thing, the feeling I have, a great ambivalence.
Right.
See, on the one hand, you have, and I deeply believe this, the Buddhist Dharma that says when you harbor anger in your heart towards someone, it's like picking up a hot coal and throwing at them. You get burned very badly. Doesn't bother him at all. I'm sure any criticism would roll off this person's back.
Right.
So I get caught between that, and when one is supposed to forgive those who have done what to me was considered evil at that time, and the natural desire to, well, it's not a natural desire, but it's something we should forgive people.
Yeah.
I mean, this I think every religion and moral code would say, well, you know, you're not gonna get over this until
absolutely.
So I would say at this point, now maybe we'll talk some more about this next week as this gets further along.
Okay.
In spite of this overwhelming PR campaign, and again we'll see how that works out. I would say to Craig Carton, for what you did to the malice that you endlessly aimed to me when you worked here, I forgive you. But I hope the judge throws the book at you.